Okay, it's very honorable today to be with you, all of you actually, and welcome to the ATSC presentation stage. And to be honest with you, like I never expected to present about ATSC 3.0, especially what's going on in Korea to Korean audience. Anyway, thank you. All right, so to introduce myself, my name is Jeaon and I'm communications manager at RAPA. Oh, sorry. Okay, so what RAPA is about? Let me just talk about the RAPA first. RAPA stands for Korea Radio Promotion Association. So obviously, as the name indicates, the headquarters is Seoul in South Korea. And our mission, the first mission is to promote broadcasting and communications industry in Korea. So as you see here, like it was established by the Korean Radio Wave Act in 1992 to serve broadcasting and communications industry in Korea. And it's entrusted by the Ministry of Science and ICT. Sorry, I cannot see that, that's so small. So let me just take a look at the screen. And also the Korean Communications Commission to undertake the government funded the project. So actually RAPA takes responsibility for the public fund project. We also represent the industry consisting of the broadcasters and wireless carriers, equipment vendors and consumer electronic makers like LG. They are one of our membership. So at present, actually, we are focusing on promoting broadcasting, especially ATSC 3.0 in South Korea and also United States and the rest of the world. Today, I'm going to just tell you more detail about what we are doing at the end of the presentation. Okay, so actually this is my old version. I think I hand you over to you the next one, but maybe it's a little bit twisted. So here's the agenda that I would like to talk about. First, I'm gonna give you the answer why Korea went with ATSC 3.0. There are a bunch of reasons, but particularly I'm gonna just give you a little bit about the behind the story. And also, I'm gonna bring you an update about ATSC 3.0 deployment, the current situation, what's going on. Is ATSC 3.0 is actually transmitting in South Korea? I'm gonna tell you about that. And who can actually watch the UHD content in South Korea? Are there all the people can watch that, or just some of them? We'll take a look at. And also, how are we gonna support the UHD ecosystem to move forward the next generation broadcasting industry? And what's the next beyond the UHD, what they are planning to do for the future? And I'm going to suggest a couple of global collaboration opportunity partnering with RAPA. Okay, so first of all, why UHD? Why did the Korea went with ATSC 3.0? Is there anyone who knows the answer? No? Okay. Basically, we can take a look at four different aspects. We can take a look at from the technological point of view, and also we can take a look at from business point of view, the government side, and also the consumer side. But as you all know about that, 4K Ultra HD is pretty much a technology-driven service. You may all know about it. The next generation broadcasting service powered by ATSC 3.0 is actually provide 4K, which is four times clearer than the HD, and also HDR and WCG. HEVC codec, which gives you two times more efficiency in coding. It also a good feature about the technology. So all the technology was available at the time we wanted to, go for the Ultra HD. And also the government side, they also took this as an opportunity to revitalize the industry, and also they can take advantage of saving the spectrum by adopting ATSC 3.0, because it has ability to save the spectrum. The government can use the other spectrum left over for other service like broadband and 5G. And by the way, the South Korea, we already started the 5G service this month. I think it was a week ago, 4th of April. Yeah, congratulations on South Korea. From the business side, ATSC 3.0 is not backward compatible. So that means, I know that the broadcaster might not like this, but from government side, we can take this as an opportunity to revitalize the industry. Like, you know, at the time, professional equipment network or solution providers, they're having some hard times. So the government, they want to put some, put some like opportunity for revitalize that industry. From the consumer side, also it has a lot of benefits for the consumers, because it can improve many of the viewing experience. I'm not describe all that, but ATSC 3.0, it gives you a lot of features and benefits for consumers. So all this work together made the Korean government set the policy in favor of ATSC 3.0, and we did it. World is first. The ATSC 3.0 launched in 2017. So in this slide, I just want to remind you of what's the difference between ATSC 1.0, which is the old system, and the new system 3.0. ATSC 3.0, it can provide like 4 times better picture, and also up to 35% better reception. The spectrum efficiency is up to 70%, and if you are a service provider, you can have more business ideas and a lot more business model, so there will be a lot more opportunity for your business, and also it can provide you better service than ATSC 1.0. I just add this slide because I just want to focus on what ATSC 3.0 can do in terms of the multi-channel transmission. So before, like you see, if you want to deliver one channel, you may have to take like the whole 6 megahertz spectrum. But because of ATSC 3.0, because it has a much better compression rate and everything, now you can use only one channel to deliver 8 different programs. This is like a maximum. We just find that out through testing and verifying. Okay, so now let's talk about what's going on actually in South Korea now. So I like this color actually. Yeah, I did a lot of job to create this design. Hopefully you like this. So this is the pathway to ATSC 3.0, what we've done in South Korea. Back in 2012, we finally we did analog switch off and started digital broadcasting using ATSC 1.2. And then in between 2012 and 2016, in I guess 2013, we already some broadcasters they started the experimental broadcasting using DVB-T2, because at the time the ATSC 3.0 was not available. But in 2016, the Korean government, they officially adopted ATSC 3.0 for the UHD broadcasting standard. And prior to the trial broadcasting, finally in 2017, Korea, the major broadcasters, they launched UHD channels in 2017 in May. And 2018, Korea hosted 2018 Winter Olympics. So the Korean government, they took this opportunity as promotion of ATSC 3.0 to the world, because this is such a big event. A lot of people actually come to Korea at the time, and they experience through the experience studio. And we actually, the RAPA ran about UHD shuttle bus, which carry those people for free inside the Olympic arena. So whoever take this bus, they actually witnessed that ATSC 3.0 is actually transmitting, and they can even receive mobile in the shuttle bus. So it was very impressive. And then right now, as of today, 2019, the broadcasters, they are planning to expand the UHD coverage, because right now the ATSC 3.0 is transmitting in Seoul and some major cities, the metropolitan area, but they have their roadmap. They want to have the full coverage of UHD nationwide by 2022. So this is the UHD coverage roadmap in South Korea. Like I said, at the stage one, you know, the ATSC 3.0 transmission is on the air in Seoul and metro area by second quarter of 2017. And at stage two, we've already done this. The coverage was expanded to the major cities by the end of 2017, right before 2018 Winter Olympics. And as of today, 2019, we are still in the second stage. Now we are on the way to the third stage, which is the nationwide UHD coverage by 2021. And eventually, we'll build more transmitters until 2027. That's our target year. When we want to switch off ATS 1.0. And by the way, we have a simulcasting route here, just like America. From 2017 to 2027, we have to, the broadcasters, they have to transmit ATS 1.0 while they keep up with ATS 3.0 roadmap. So from 2017 to 2027, they still have to simulcast. Okay, so this is a spectrum issue as of today, present. As you can see here, by the way, most of you already know that Korean government, they put aside 700 megahertz for UHD broadcasting. It's not like America. So I know that a lot of US broadcasters, they are jealous about it, and we are lucky. So this is the current situation about broadcasting spectrum. Situation right now, the low VHF from 54 to 88 is allocated for analog broadcasting, but it's not being used since 2012 because we switch off the analog. And in high VHF, between 174 to 216, is allocated for the TDMB. TDMB is the Korean mobile broadcasting. And in UHF, from 470 to 698, this is the spectrum we use for ATSC 1.0 right now at this moment. And like I said, in 700 megahertz, we have 30 megahertz bandwidth for UHD broadcasting. The government assigned five different channels. So right now in Korea, five channels are being run for UHD program. Okay, so this is about the current situation. And like you see, the DTV, the spectrum from 470 to 698, there is no more spectrums available. So this means soon in the future, we may have to repack the spectrum once we have ATSC 1.0 switch off which is 2027. Sure, this is my specific plan about the spectrum. At stage one, we are already in stage one. So 472.698 is allocated for HDTV, and some part of the 700 megahertz is allocated for UHDTV, the orange color. At the stage two, by 2027, we are expecting that, and we are trying to do that. Once it happens, we have to move the UHD channels to the UHF spectrum. I'm not sure like if I can point this. No. Yeah, and also at the stage three, at certain point, we want to allocate a certain spectrum in UHF for 8K broadcasting. And we want to save up this amount of spectrum for other service, maybe in the future. Okay, so now the problem is ATSC 3.0 is already transmitting in South Korea. But the thing is, the people can actually watch the UHD broadcasting. There's a lot of content available. The answer is yes or no. Yeah, right now we are, right now is in 2019. The broadcasters, they are supposed to program 50% in native UHD. But at the beginning of 2019, which I consider today, they're almost like 10%, but they are trying to reach 15% by the end of this year. Okay? And I see that like it will be almost half the broadcasting program is gonna be naked UHD by 2023, and 2027 it's gonna be 100%, because they have to, because they have to switch off ATSC 1.0. Right now we have three major broadcasting network: KBS, NBC, and SBS. They're all trying to produce as much UHD content as possible. At this point, they are pretty much like producing UHD for those contents which needs more clearer picture and more like a moving picture stuff. So for example, they are producing drama rerun and also documentary, entertainment, and some animations. Okay, so, oh sorry, let me just introduce this first. Okay, I got this video clip from KBS, one of the major broadcasting network in South Korea. This is gonna show you clearly how the KBS got ready to transmit ATSC 3.0. It was recorded back in 2017. I guess it's around in February. Let's enjoy. It's not supposed to be like this. Counting down. Okay. Wow. Okay, so that was very nicely, generously given by the KBS, and thank you very much for appreciate for letting me introduce you guys about this video clip. Okay, so now we're gonna take a look at who can actually watch UHD in South Korea. Here you go. So what this tells you about is, as of today, ATSC 2.0 signal covers Seoul and major cities, and nearly 67% of the Korean population have access to the UHD program, but in a certain condition. So if you can take a look at the right hand side, this is this represents about the coverage of UHD using ATSC 3.0. It covers about 67%, meaning that almost like 12.9 million households and 33 million population. On the right hand side, this is about ATSC 1.0. Obviously, it's supposed to cover 100%, but to be honest with you, it's around like a 98% something. And this is the entire population in Korea. So it's almost pretty much we are doing good job. Okay, so this is the estimation of the UHTV sold in Korea. But unfortunately, my apologies is there is no information available. There's no data about the TV sales in Korea. It's kind of a secret. So I made an assumption for this slide. My assumption is those consumer electronic companies, they will produce the US television as projected by their sales target. So what I mean is I just equalize the UHTV produced to the UHTV sold in South Korea. Okay, this is the maximum I could do. So let me just explain about this slice. If you take a look at line down there, it's the number of TV produced. So for example, in 2016, it's almost like 2.1 million UHTV was produced. And 2017, it's a little bit going down, so 20 million. 2018, 22 million. And 2019, it's going down again. So the number of TV produced fluctuate up and down year by year. But if you see the percentage over there, it never fluctuates. It's just, you know, going, increasing again and again. It just keep growing. So it started from in 2016, 24%, grow up to 34%. And by 2018, everyone purchase out of the TV sales was UHD television. So at this moment, every half of the TV purchase is a UHD television in South Korea. Okay? So here's some mathematics. Who's good at math? So how many TV has been produced in South Korea? Yeah, it's not easy, huh? I calculated for you guys. So if we sum up all together here, you could get this number, 3.8 million ATSC 3.0 embedded TV set has been produced, meaning has been sold in South Korea. Do you believe this? But be careful, because there is some myself number. So I'm gonna just give you about the complexity of the UHTV sold in Korea. That's because of two different standards should be mentioned about these slides. So let's take a look at the history first. I'm gonna just read out for you guys. So Korea started UHD experimental broadcasting using DVB-T2 since 2013. And the TV makers already started selling UHTV products from the time above. And UHTV sold in Korea in this stage equipped to receive DVB-T2 only, not ATSC 3.0. Do I have some time now? Or how many more minutes left? 10 minutes? Okay, 10 minutes. All right, so And the Korea officially adopted ATSC 3.0 for UHD broadcasting standard in 2016. And only the UHTV sold after first quarter of 2017 has ATSC 3.0 chipset integrated in the product. What about then, before 2017, people still bought UHD television, but it was not with ATSC 3.0, it was with DVB-T2. Now what about them? Can they still watch ATSC 3.0? Because they don't have ATSC 3.0 chipset inside. So that's why the TV manufacturers like, you know, Samsung and LG, they made it available, which is called UHD Solution Kit, which you can connect to your existing TV so that you can still receive ATSC 3.0 signal. Okay, so I would say it's a little more than 3.8 million households can receive ATSC 3.0 from their home. That's because this much amount, 3 million, and from 2015 and 2017, which we can track down, is another 0.8 million. But unfortunately, from 2013 and 2015, there's no data. So I would say it's 3.8 million plus alpha. This is an example of, like I told you, the UHD solution kit. It has HDMI interface, so people can buy the UHF antenna. If they have with a DVB-T2 tuner in it, they can still watch the ATSC 3.0 using the UHD solution kit. It's available, I think the price is around $100 American. All right, so this is kind of an example of the housing type that is a different way to receive ATSC 3.0 signal. If you live in the house right there, simply you can have UHF antenna, and depending on what kind of television set you have, if you have ATSC 3.0, nothing, congratulations, you can watch ATSC 3.0 UHD television right now at home. If you don't have it, you can simply buy the converter to connect it. This is the most popular style of housing in Korea, mostly 70% living in the apartment. So if you live in the apartment, you can still have like your own UHF antenna, but you can have MATB, the master antenna television system, which is very, very well developed in Korea. So simply you can have it, then you don't have extra UHF antenna for yourself, and you can watch 3.0 UHF television. I was going to just ask you some question and then quiz stuff and give you out some gift, but because I don't have enough time, I'm going to just skip this. Anyway. All right, so how are we going to support the UHD ecosystem? Now, the Ministry of Science and ICT. So on behalf of the ministry, we have two standing out organizations. One is RAPA, which I work for, and the other one is ATRI. This is a national research institution. What RAPA does for support this industry is we finance, we provide the financial assistance and cash grants and those kind of things to, you know, support UHD content production. This year is the budget is of almost about like $7 million, which is good enough. And we also organize and, you know, support the exhibition for the related industry, and also international project to expand ATSC 3.0 deployment. For example, we are working with the Dominican Republic from 2018, and this year we give them some consulting, what's actually ATSC 3.0 and what's going to be the benefit. We also give out them some test equipment set for free and those kind of things. The ATRI, what they do is they're doing incredible job actually to, you know, promote ATSC 3.0. Right now, they are doing ATSC 3.0 advanced EAS, the emergency alerting system, service mode. They develop service model and use cases, and also the system. And they are developing master antenna TV system, which I showed you earlier, and also seamless convergence of broadcast and broadband, terrestrial, AK using ATSC 3.0 channel, bonding, and more. You can see all this in reality when you go to the Futures Park over there. You can find Korea UHD on air. You can see all the exhibition down there. What's next? Beyond the UHD, what are you gonna do? Well, is Korea, is the mobile available in Korea? Yes, it is. Is the mobile using 83.0? No, it isn't. There's a bunch of reasons I'd like to talk about, but because I don't have enough time. Right now, in Korea, we use TDMB system for mobile broadcasting. So this is some of history of the DBB, DMB. So we started from the early DMB. It goes through BIFS. It's just, you know, evolved the technology, DMB 2.0. And right now it's HD DMB, which features with HEVC with 720p video quality. And our next step is still under the question. It depends on the policy. It depends on the business matter. So maybe next year around this time, I could be able to, you know, give you some updates about the mobile in Korea. So being more positive, if we make the transition to ATSC 3.0 for mobile, this is the present. Right now, we need two different spectrum for fixed HD, and one is for mobile. But once we adapt ATSC 3.0 into the mobile, that means we only need 6 megahertz because of, we call the LDM technology. We can transmit like two different within one megahertz. What about the receiver? Is the receiver available? Yes. In addition to Samsung and LG television set, we also have a mobile receiver, which is called the ATSC 3.0 USB dongle. And also we have a setup box. And we also have the home gateway. So, you know, you can just simply connect that those receivers to your handheld device, tablet PC, and everything. And these products are already proven from a couple of demos. And also in United States, when you have TG3 meeting, some vendors, they actually display their products and they show them the product is already ready and it's proven, working very well. There are three major broadcasters in Korea, KBS, MBC, and SBS. They working together to create a TV bar service. TV bar is interactive broadcasting service, which is integration of, you know, broadcasting and broadband. This is just like a European HBB TV. It's very similar service. And also, like I mentioned about that, AT3 and KBS and a couple of broadcasters and system developers, they are developing advanced EAS using ATSC 3.0. You can also see more detail at the Korea UHD on exhibition. We are considering PCBB hybrid service. We are also considering advanced TPEG for the next generation broadcasting service. Finally, global collaboration. So what do you want to do next? We are looking forward to the launch of ATSC 3.0 in your country, in the United States. And in that sense, RAPA would like to welcome any opportunities to work with US broadcasters. Like you see here, maybe RAPA can help you to set your trial ATSC 3.0 broadcasting. I know that there are a couple of broadcasters there already testing ATSC 3.0 here and there in Phoenix, Baltimore, everywhere. If you want to join with this kind of opportunity, you can anytime remind of RAPA. And also in cooperation with NAB, we are holding the Global UHD Conference since 2017. This conference is a pretty good opportunity actually to learn about ATSC 3.0 and what's going on and everything. This year it's going to be held in South Korea in May. If you know about the COBA exhibition, COBA is just like NAB broadcasting exhibition. If you have a chance to come over there, free conference, free lunch, but air ticket is not free. And these are the membership of RAPA. So these are all the companies producing ATSC 3.0 related products. They're very reliable. They're pretty good companies, I can guarantee. If you are interested in these companies, I can link you up with that vendors. I mentioned earlier a little bit about Dominican Republic. Just like this, we also try to try pushing hard for ATSC 3.0 global deployment. So last year we had already in a good relationship with Dominican Republic. So now they are trying to select the standard for DTTP transition, the digital transition. And ATSC 3.0 is one of the strong candidates for them. We have a bunch of partnering projects for ATSC 3.0. So you can just, you know, take as a reference for this. This year, we are starting a collaboration with Bangladesh. So what I'm trying to tell you is there are a lot more countries other than United States. There are more countries, they are getting more interested in ATSC 3.0. That's because of strong features and benefits of this standard. You've heard about this so many times during my presentation. Yes, it is. It's N231 future spot. You can go there. You can learn about more about what I've told you in my presentation. Okay, so there's no time, but maybe if there's any question, I can get maybe one. Otherwise, thank you very much for listening. I really appreciate for your time. And if you have any more question, I'll be always there. You can just come to me, ask. Thank you very much.